This week we have Nick Deshano and Bruce is here also. They own Offshore Tackle. You guys have all heard of Offshore one way or another. They're the leaders in the inline trolling boards, definitely. Nick hangs out in Harbor Beach quite a bit, and he also fishes in the summertime in Harbor Beach. He's got the lake to himself, so it's probably about time we start crowding him a little bit. He does pretty well out there in the middle of summer, so yeah, it's our job to get that out. So, with that said, go ahead, Nick.
Well, as you said, I've had offshore marine on Harbor Beach the last 10 years, so I spent some time and seen it. I got in just as the last couple of years of the good salmon fishing, so I've seen the whole cycle of everything going down, and for the while you were just fishing for lake trout, you didn't even worry about fishing for anything else. And in the last couple of years, the only time I went fishing for lake trout was when my wife told me, said, I want lake trout for dinner, so we went out and bossed the bottom and caught a few lake trout. So it's really turned into a nice mixed bag fishery, like this whole side up and down here. You can get steelhead, coho, get some nice kings. If you're going to do the kings, they're going to be up until usually this year, you never know. Usually a normal year, the first couple weeks of June, we've been getting decent kings. Last year and right in ice out in that late April and May, it's been some decent sized fish. 15, 16 pound kings haven't been anything unheard of. It's not like the old days where somebody got a 15 pound king and everybody from the marina runs to the dock to go see this fish. So things are looking up a lot better than they have in the last few years. The lake trout are always there. They're always fun to catch. They're same thing. There's a suspended group of them, or you can go out and fish the bottom for the big ones. I'd rather catch a little, you know, the 5 or 6 pounders anyway, so I'd rather fish the suspended lake trout. Things have changed a lot. We were talking since he was fishing the salmon out of Port Austin and Harbor Beach in the 80s, and compared to now, it's two totally different deals. The old days, as many downriggers as you can fit on the back of the boat and then stacking your lines, and the old outriggers with a couple dipsies or something out there, and you know, now it's you put a couple riggers on the boat and you're running your coppers and your lead core lines, and which isn't as user-friendly to use. We've got a few ways that I do it that makes it a lot easier for me to use it, and a lot easier for every day just to use it without being such a hassle. I've got a rule on our boat that is not putting out any more than 300 foot of copper line. That's it. So if you got to catch it at 450, there's other ways of getting down with that 300 foot that I can match what everybody else is doing with a 450. So, and working on rods, you know, I got 23 rods in the boat for two of us to cycle through all this stuff. So one of the things we've been using is our newest product, is what's called the tadpole. So what this does is the standard setup is it's a diving planer weight. So this front part goes to your line, your rod, and then off here you put a leader, like you would stick your dipsy, just like running a dipsy. And then what happens is that'll dive down, and when the fish gets on it, it'll trip. You're not fighting that diving all the way to the boat. So it makes it a lot nicer, and it's a lot lighter than like for like this. This is a Magnum, and we've gotten with 150 foot of 30 pound power pro at 2.5 mile an hour, we've hit bottom at 65 feet. So this is getting right up there with a full core of lead, and not quite copper depths, but you know at least a full core of lead with 150 feet of lino. You put 150 feet of a 20 pound mono, and you're right up there, you know, 40 feet down, just right where the lead core is, and you're using the same rigger rod. You don't have to have a special rod for all this, so you can cut that down a lot. One of the ways we're doing we're taking a full core of lead, and this is a number two tadpole. We got four sizes. There's a 1-2. I don't have a 1, but this is a 3. And then this is our big one, the Magnum. And then the Magnum is about 4.5 ounces, and just a lead weight. To get to the same depth, you're looking at using at least an 8 ounce weight to get the same depth this is going to get you. And the nice thing with these, since they do have a plane, you can get a dive curve on them. whereas this, like the snap weights and just a heavy weight chart, it's so speed dependent that any little adjustment of speed, the weights are going all over the place. You can kind of bracket it in, but this, you can look up on the Precision Trolling's got the, I think it's on the app, and I know you get the stickers for it, and it's also on our website. And okay, well, I want to go 20 feet down, I put it 110 feet back, and it's going to be right in that range. So what we found is by taking a full core of lead and putting this in with a 50-foot leader, instead of hooking your bait up to the leader on the end of your leg core, you hook this on it and then hook a leader off of that. So you put your spoon behind it. And what that'll do is that'll get you fishing the same depth with 10 colors of lead that these guys are doing 300 feet of copper.
Gives you 15 feet more depth. Yeah. 50-foot lead with that gives you 15 feet on top of what the dive, the lead core or the copper core says you're going to get.
You can use a chart. So you take the end of your copper or lead. So you know, you put all your leader out. So you put this on.
Yeah, I got it on there somewhere.
Here we go.
Line and let it out. You put your lure on a 6-foot lead, put it on your line, now you let your lead core. What we're trying to do is get you down where you don't have to run, you know, two half cores, two full cores, two 150s, two 300s.
I don't know about that.
This will give you a full core or additional 15 feet. If you know, we've all got the full core already, so you're not going to get rid of it. But that 50-foot leader will give you 15 additional feet.
The way it works, you take, as far as the depth and how much deeper this will get you, so this is a number 2 tadpole. Okay, you look on the chart, number 2 tadpole, if you got a 50-foot leader from between here and your copper, you'd look at the chart for 50 feet at your speed, and that determines the depth. It doesn't matter how much line you've got out from the reel, the depth, 90%, most of the depth is coming from the end of the copper or the lead and the monofilament from there. And then you'll, so if you want to, and I haven't experimented a whole lot with putting, you know, 100 feet leaders out, and it's just, to me, 50 seems to be good, because that's kind of what your average leader is, a little, anyways, maybe a little longer than normal, but that 50 feet will get you that extra 12 to 15 feet that you'll need. With this setup, you've got to run a leader behind it. So I found in the spring you can get away with shorter leaders. Just you know, your old slider, you pull it out, and okay, my leader is about that long. Well, as you get later in the year and the water gets warmer and the fish get up a little more, you want to stretch the leader out basically as long as you're comfortable running. We went from 6-foot leads to 10-foot leads and seen a pickup in the fish with that little extra leader. So what we're trying to do with these is mimic, you know, the copper and the lead and get away from having to use so much of that. So then we ended up with these, the bigger ones we come out with. So what we decided to do, well, how do I get a, you know, what if I want to, instead of limited to a 6 or 8 foot lead behind the tadpole, now with this setup, we put two releases on it, now you can run 100-foot leader behind it. So now we'll put the spoon out, or this will hold, this tadpole will stay set behind a regular dodger, a rotator, not the big 12-inch paddles, but like a spin doctor rotating paddle, an 8-inch model and stuff, that'll stay set just on its own. As long as you get it, the key is to get it in the water and get it set, but it'll haul that kind of stuff behind it. But now you can run, especially with the spoons, we just put this part on the line here. And these red releases, they've got a pin right in the center of the pads. So the line, as long as you put the line behind the pin, they're not coming off of that line. And then the key with this is you're just gonna let a little slack between the two releases. So you've got a loop like that. Now you can run as long a lead as you want out the back. When a fish pulls on, it still trips. And you're not fighting the diving of that. So And that really seemed to be a big difference. We were running a thing like that up on, we were fishing Bay of Quinte for walleye with crankbait though. We were running a big reef runner, 35 feet back, putting the reef runner out 35 feet, flipping a number two tadpole on it, and setting them out another 90 feet. So we had about 110 feet of line out, whereas before we had to put just a reef runner out 200 feet. And now we've got a lot less line out, and it takes a lot less time to set it.
With that reef runner out there, we're doing 1-4. So when you got a fish, to start off with, the guys we fished with said, all our fish come on the outside boards. So we put this on the inside. But every time we brought a fish in, we had the inside board tangled with their 200-foot leads. We put this out, now we've only got 110 on our inside. We caught as many fish on our inside board where they never catch fish as they did on their outside. So essentially, we doubled their catch next fall when they start picking this up. We've doubled the amount of fish they're going to catch. And we had a lot of 11-12-pound, more 12-pound fish than we really. And the nice thing up there is the reason they get 12 and 14-pound fish in Quinte, they don't keep any fish. And that fish come in, took pictures, back in the water. So we're not going to get a 15-pounder if we eat all the 11s and 10s and 9s. So I was really surprised at that. And they're salmon the same way. They'll catch a salmon. Nick got a steelhead that was big. And we didn't weigh it or anything. We took pictures of it, back in the water. So that's how you get big fish, is by letting them 10s go, keeping the 2s and 3s and 4s, which is hard for us to do. I mean, I want to bring a 10-pounder in and show it, but that's why they get 12-pound fish in Quinte very, very regular. You don't even turn a head when you bring in a 30-inch fish in that place.
Now, going specifically for how we use these, fish in the spring of the year around the break walls, and just on the inside of the humps at 50, 60-foot line, if you go straight out and a little bit south, there's a couple series of humps that run for maybe a mile down.
About a mile.
And they kind of converge like that, and you work the humps in the spring inside, and then that's when we'll use these smaller ones. And we'll put a streak or a spoon behind it. Like I said, in the spring I'll run 6. I'll probably start out at 8 feet just because I'm getting a little more comfortable with the longer leads. I don't want to get to a point where I got to hand line it into the boat the rest of the way. That's just nothing I want to deal with. But so we'll start our setup. We'll run out typically in the spring. As soon as we clear the channel, when we drop off into the shipping channel, we're setting lines. Put a couple riggers down in the corner, maybe 4 or 5 feet just under the surface, and put a couple like a thunder stick or a couple bombers. And run that stuff out there. We'll set these out 15 feet back behind the boards and just kind of troll along our way. We don't spend too much time in there, but it's always good first thing in the morning to take a little peek. And if you get something, you can come around and swing back and take another thing out there. But there's no point in putting it up on plane and wallowing out and then setting down anyway. So this way you're fishing. You troll right on out there. And we usually go around the gap and we make a couple passes along there. And then And that's the same thing, because you're fishing that 30 to 40-foot stuff. And in the morning, usually if they're there, they're there. We don't spend a whole lot of time working it out. And especially when there's tournament day where there's a lot of boats, usually you can get a pass or two and get a fish out of there, and then that's pretty much it. You know, maybe you can wait them out. If everybody leaves early, you can sneak back in, or you just kind of hang out. When you see it opening up, you kind of sneak back in and make another pass, and the fish will settle down a little bit.
Quite often that'll be a steelhead or a brown in there when you clear the gap. And then after you get to the 30, 40 foot, then you'll start seeing salmon. And don't be afraid to go fast. It scared us a couple of years ago. I mean, we were just, there's no way. The water is 37 degrees and we're doing 3.8. And we had salmon going. So try it. I mean, the worst case scenario you got, you covered a couple miles a lot quicker than a 2.2. And if the fish are on it, you're not going to pull it away from a fish. We all know that if the fish wants it, he's going to get it. And by going fast, you don't give him the opportunity to, let's see, does that have 3 dots and 1 stripe on it? Or, he's got to either eat it or forget it. So.
And, you know, the brown trout, they'll be hanging out. If you guys ever fished out of it, there's a cemetery, which is about a couple miles south of the harbor. But pretty much that whole water it's fishable through there in the spring. The fish move around, the breakwall is a big anchor point, and the cemetery, which isn't too far away. I mean, if we're fishing a tournament where you know this is your spot, we're liable to go there just because we know that that's where they're going to be. But and same thing, if we just work in that, start out in that shallow stuff in the spring, I mean, I don't think you can get too shallow for them in the spring with these browns. These guys they're going right along as shallow as they're comfortable to run their boat, and then putting their boards with a little spoon out as far as they can get it running up along in the rocks, feeling along in the rocks there for the browns. There's not too many people do it as much anymore, but 10 years ago when I first got in there, as soon as the ice was out, like 2 days later when they found the ice was out, there was a group of people up there fishing, and they're catching browns as soon as they can get on the water. I mean, they got their snowsuits and everything on there, but I mean, there's been good fishing, and it just hasn't been enough bodies around lately to get anything like that going and to get a good program of what's going on out there. As the year goes on, you know, the fish move a little deeper. Those humps, you can spend all summer long fishing that little mile and a half long stretch and from the shore all the way out to 90, 100 foot of water and catch fish in there pretty much all year round. And it's not real crowded. There's more of the structure. It's probably the main reason. It's some of the most structure we've got around there as far as our area. And, you know, unless you get up around Lighthouse Park and in that area. But for us, that's pretty much the main spot. And there's not... Nice thing with Harbor Beach is 6 miles is a long run out of Harbor Beach.
Yeah.
You know, you can pull out, you can go north, and you can fish good waters up there. There's not too far from there, there's a Dunderberg, and that's a good anchor point later in the year for steelhead. A lot of steelhead hang around out there, and again, it's just open water, so that's why we like to go fast. We'll fish fast for steelhead, and we'll get out, and after the first couple hour bite's gone, and the things have slowed up, we'll put everything up, and we'll be running 3.8, 4 mile an hour, running around, going all the way up to 200 foot of water, but just popping steelhead out there.
And that's only 6 miles, 200 foot straight out, Harbor Beach. So you don't even have to put the boat on plane. Everybody's, you know, we've all got our favorite spots. You know, yeah, we got to burn that $5 gasoline. Probably this summer it'll be $5. And you can put stay on trolling mode, and go straight east for 6 miles, you'd be in 200 foot of water, lay around on the bottom, stay right up high on the top, turn around and troll back in again, and now you've burned, what, 4 gallons of gas instead of 12, and we're out there to go fishing. If it was a tournament, we're going to where we gotta go, but then you take the family out, you idle your way out, idle your way back in again, and there's good fish. The walleye are gonna surprise you. We don't know where they're at. Our 300 foot copper caught more walleye than trying to catch walleye with our other rig.
Yeah, that. So 2 years ago, my best walleye rig was 300 foot copper with a Magnum Blue Dolphin behind it at 3 miles an hour. And it was because every day it would catch at least 2 to 3 walleye out there. But when the water's 70 degrees top to bottom and 110 foot of water, the fish will be anywhere. They just seem to be
look for food.
Yeah. So, with the coho, a lot of you guys know this. The good old little red dodger. This is an old wobble glow we pulled out of his tackle box from 1985, and this thing still catches coho with this little setup here. What's nice with this little dodger, you can put it behind the tadpole, and put the tadpole down 15 feet behind the board. So now you're running. You're running this way out to the side. So you've got another option for here. A lot of the guys that run that fish just for coho, they'll have 12, 14 rods out, and 12 rods will have that dodger and a lot of times, whether it's a little fly or something like that on the back of it. But this right here is just, that little dodger's probably killed more coho than anything I could think of out on the ice.
Well, and running on a tadpole, we flatlined it quite a bit, but the dodger would have a tendency, if it caught a wave just right, it'd come up to the top and then it would skip along, and you got it way out, you couldn't tell it. But putting it on the tadpole, you know it's staying down there, and 15 feet back, you're 5 or 6 foot down, you're right in that correct zone for And there's more coho out here than we think, but we're underneath them too much. We're down, you know, we're down fishing. Even when we started our spring fishing, we're 15. We got the ball set at 12, 15, 18. And then a bomber behind it. Well, you're another 50 foot back on a bomber, you're another 6 foot now. So you're underneath more fish than you think. You gotta keep a couple on the surface. Fish will come from 30, 40 feet of water to the surface to eat food, to eat, get a minnow, but they won't go down 1 foot. So if you're gonna screw up high. If they're not gonna go down at all. They make a living attacking from the bottom.
Any questions on the tadpole stuff? I guess I got one more thing I can show, and then if you guys got anything on that, we can follow up with some of that. So we're kind of stay on that same subject. This setup here to keep the action of the copper. So I can run like if I want to run my 300 foot copper or 10 colors of lead to run the same depth these guys that they're running, you know, 300 coppers or the 400 coppers with my 10 colors of lead. I'll put this on with the same setup with the releases. The difference is I've got an orange one on the front, so it can trip if I want it to, but I've got a rubber banded in place here. Now that's going to make it a little tougher reeling in. But what that does is you get that much weight behind it, and that becomes sometimes it tends to be a little too much to keep this set all the time. So I put the rubber band on here, and that locks it in place. So now what I can do is I can, instead of putting it like on the end of the leader of the copper, I put it all out like I was normally going to set the copper or the lead. And then right after the lead is out, then I clip this back on the line. So now I can run kind of like, some of you guys might have used the dive bombs or something like that, how you put it right in line with the whereas this thing has got a real good diving planing ability. And this will run in front, so now you've got your added depth to the lead is in front of it. So you've got the whole action. And I think there's a lot to that sweeping action of the lead. And I think that's why everybody likes the longer leads on the dipsies and all that stuff. You get a little smoother action, and some days they like a little more erratic. But so now you can put it in front of your lead, and then put it out another 100 feet. And you're still putting another 100 feet of line out, but I'd much rather have to put another 100 feet of backer out and another 100 feet of copper or something like that out and get a big giant reel. You know, so, it's, you know, you get kids in, you get people that aren't used to it. It's not a whole lot of, it's not really fun to me to reel in a 300 foot copper, let alone a 450 or 500 and all this big stuff. And that's the main thing. And out here, it's about keeping it fun. You know, I mean, we're not.
Yeah. Your curve, again, is from the tadpole to the rod. So if you go to your chart, 100 foot of line gives you 25 feet. You take that number and your copper, 300 foot of copper gives you 70 feet. Now you add those two together. So it's from the tadpole to the rod tip or to the planer board is how you can determine your depth. So now we can get to 400, 450, anywhere you want to go with that. And anytime there's a 300 or more on the boat, I back up when the fish goes, and I point to him. Fish eye. I'm out of here. I'm not cranking in 300 foot of copper. If I was running the charter, I wouldn't book the guy twice that made me fight 300 foot of copper. But here we can get you with five colors, or with 150 foot of copper. We can get you to 300, and you've still got that long, subtle action of the 150 copper. But he's only got a reel in now. He reels in 100 feet of power pro, and much easier on you.
Instead of having to deal with 23 rods, you can get that down to 15.
Yeah.
You know, that's the hardest thing with me getting used to all this stuff is him and I fishing in the boat most of the time, and you look and you open a rod locker, we got two rod lockers stuffed full of rods. And we can only put six in the water at one time, and yet we got, you know, seven or eight lead rods. We got seven or eight different coppers, and it just used to be so much to manage. Or if we can cut the number of that stuff down by using these things. And we're gonna have, I know Precision Trolling Data, they're working on doing more dive charts with in conjunction with this on the line, so to have actual data of this in front of the copper and off the leader. And yeah, right now, we're pretty confident between our testing and their testing and where we can get, but they're really hoping to be able to pin that right down so you know that that's okay. So next to this, that's going to get me 57 feet instead of 42 feet.
Well, the tadpole isn't affected as bad. Guys, so why we can just run an 8-ounce inline sinker. If you change your speed when you're running a non-diving hunk of weight, it's going to radically change where that lead is at in the water. I mean, you go out in this river, we can take the number 3 tadpole and bounce the bottom of this river. How much lead would it take you to hold the bottom of this river? What are you, a pound and a half? You know, you're just not going to get there with the speed of this river. But the tadpole has its own, since it's got a lip, it's not as speed dependent as a hunk of lead, as our guppy weights would be. They're a lot more sensitive to speed, where this one's pretty stable. And Mark has proven that with all his diving work. And like Nick said, he's got a whole lot more he wants to do, because the more we play with this, the more, well, what if we did this, and what if we did that? It becomes a new product all over again, even though it's been out for a few years. We're finding new ways, just clipping it on. And did you tell them how you hook your copper with the lead copper to your backing?
Oh, yeah, it's with the mono?
Yeah.
Yeah, I learned that the hard way. I first started using copper. I'd run my backer right to the copper, and then I'd run a monofilament lead out the end of that. Well, after I spit my first 300 foot of copper out behind the boat, I kind of realized that, and then talking with some other people, that now I run from between my backer and the copper, I put a 4 foot section of monofilament, and then the 30-40 pound monofilament to put the board onto. Because these boards, even with this snapper, which will hold onto the backer, you know, this will hold fine on the backer. If you do get any kind of slipping, if it trips, this release is going to slide. Any kind of rubber pinch pad like that, it's still going to slide down. And especially because I use Power Pro for backer, and that's some of the most abrasive stuff out there, so it's like a saw. And this stuff just slides, but what it does is it slides down, and then it runs into that knot. And then after a few times of hitting that knot, it weakens that knot. And then eventually, it's going to break the knot off from that copper. So by putting the monofilament on there, you can clip this on there, and it's not going anywhere with the monofilament. This is a board. I'll show you this setup here in a little bit. But to finish the tadpole, are there any other questions about tadpoles? Or
do you use just mono at all? I mean, no.
With the tadpoles?
Yeah.
Sure. Just with like a 20 pound test mono, and with the Magnum tadpole, you can get right down to 10 color lead lengths fairly easy. You know, with
say a guy doesn't want to make an investment in a 10 color, no. He can take one of his rigger rods and do this.
Yep. Take a rigger rod, yep, you take your regular rod, you put this out, and that's where I think this two release system is really going to shine. So if you don't have copper and you don't want to mess with it, you just take your regular rigger rod. And I would suggest, because typically your lead lengths for the copper is 35 to 50 feet. So I'd go anywhere from 35 to 50 feet, put your spoon out. The biggest thing that these won't pull is if you're running the big rotating meat rigs and all that mess. But for your spoons and your dodgers, any crankbait, anything up to those 8-inch rotators even, will still stay set behind this. So other than that, you kind of treat it like a dipsy. But it pulls out on the board easier than the copper does. You know, it does everything that'll do. And by using that longer lead, that mimics it. So we'll run, say we want to fish where guys, they're getting fish on full color, full core of lead, 10 colors of lead. So I'll put my spoon out 40 feet back, clip this on the line, leave it a loop so it can still trip. And then I just look in the guide and say, okay, I need to put it back 175 feet, 180 feet or whatever to get down to that 40 foot, 38 foot where that lead is getting. And then you just put it back and send it out on the board, or you can run it straight out the back if you want it, because it tracks It tracks fairly true. It kind of wanders around nice. It doesn't go crazy. But what happens is it pulls, the water loads up on it because it's a flat. It's not a tapered side. So the water will load up on it, and it just kind of dumps itself off. So when it dumps, it just kind of, it's not making big crazy stuff behind your boat, but it'll go through, and it'll just kind of flutter around back and forth like that a little bit. So it's not like you got to worry. If you got two side by side, they're going to be crossed, and they don't do that much. So we run them straight off the back of the boat. Sneaky way of doing it. The guys, here's some of the guys talking about SWR rig, where they'll run lead core off the downriggers, like three colors of lead off a downrigger to get the bait a long ways away from the cannonball when they're worried about the clear water. You can put this back 50 feet, put it on your downrigger, and then set it down. So now you got this big cannonball up here, and your bait's way away from the cannonball and the hum of the lines and all that stuff. So it's another way of setting that.
It's so new that you guys are going to tell us more than we know about it once you get out there and put some time on it and experiment. Don't get stuck in what we're telling you is how it has to be done. Go throw them in the water, do something. Worst case scenario, you take them off and go back to the way you were fishing before. But we're looking for input. So if you guys come up with an idea that, hey, I've done this and we really caught fish off a sand lac, we bounced the sand with it or whatever, let us know. And we'll put a little article in here. We'll get it on our Facebook site, which is getting more and more popular.
We got a lot of videos. We'll send the Facebook page. We'll put more videos and how-to stuff and a lot of, you know, it's hard. We've been doing this stuff for so long to go back and think, okay, well, there's some people that don't know all this. You know, to us, there's so many little things that we're used to doing because that's what we do. So we're trying to find ways, and if there's things like video-wise that you guys don't see out there or something, well, hey, why don't you make a video on the release? Well, why don't you make a video on how you set this so it's behind the line? There's so many of those things. We're used to it, and okay, you clip it behind the line, and there it is. So we're trying to come out with some videos that start right from the ground up. So it runs you right through it. And we've got a good array of everything, but a lot of the stuff we don't think of. So we're open to any suggestions and ideas, and as you guys play with this kind of stuff a little more and work with some more of that stuff, you come up with questions or ideas, feel free to drop us an email there, or get a hold of Joel, or get a hold of me over in Hover Beach, and you know, input is awesome. I love hearing input, good or bad, something you don't like it. I want to hear that too. The last thing I need is, you know, telling me everything's awesome and this is the best and that's the best. There's always somehow you can improve on something. And if you don't get enough good input, it's hard to improve on that. So
one quick little tip is to keep it from sliding, especially if you're running the Power Pro and stuff. Make a loop, give it a twist like that. And then put the line, we'll do this one. This one doesn't have the pin in the middle. It's the same tension as a red one. Now you put your line in here, and if hold on,
well, let's trip it.
Now it'll only slide that much, and it'll trip. Where if you pinched it on this way, it could slide, and it's going to cut the pads. There's nobody out there that makes a release with a pad. If you run especially braid through it, it's going to cut it. You guys all know that. You've tried knots and pulled on it like that and cut your hands. The stuff is brutal. I don't use it trolling. I don't use it walleye fishing. I use it for vertical jigging and backing and dipsy divers and stuff. But that little twist, Mark Romanek, he doesn't put anything in the water. He's got that twist in the snapper. It's so easy to do. And you're done. Downriggers with the big OR8.
Yeah.
When you're running them big flashers and stuff, they can sit there and they'll work that line right through the release, or you go to trip it and you end up pulling the line right, the lure right up to the release. Do this, it's coming off. So just a little, that's one of the little things that we don't mention because we just do it automatic.
Get the heat seal.
And
Childproof.
And then for the guys running the salmon boards, Nick's going to show you how we've...
We'll show you. This is a release here with obviously the wire on it, but a lot of you used to the old black OR1 regular standard downrigger release, and for a lot of years that's been fine, but that release was designed when spoons and dodgers and stuff like that, and you didn't have a big 12-inch rotator with all this stuff behind it dragging it down, and that's a little of a light release for that. So now pretty much all we use is this red. This one is originally designed as a muskie release off a planer board. It's a heavy tension, so it's got an extra spring in it, but with this will hold anything that an inline release will hold. This will hold that. I mean, it's been tested hauling real heavy stuff at 7 miles an hour, and it stays set. But that's where it's key. If you just set your rigger and just clip it on the line like you normally do from the boat, you'll probably break the rod before you trip the release. It's that heavy of a release. The fish can pull it out, but with all the stretch and that you got, it's so hard you gotta trip it. So what you do is the same thing. I just make the loop, make a little loop, and then you pinch it in that loop. And it still maintains its tension going out, but from the top, it can pull that loop free, and then you can trip it out that way. So that's the key to a lot of that, is running that tight. And we like running with this that's got the wire on it, especially lake trout fishing. With the cable, you can watch your rod tips. So you get a fish coming up, or the fish comes up and slaps on it, you can see the release moving around a little bit more. You got a little leeway if salmon comes up and he's slapping at it back and forth. It's not rigid on the line, so it doesn't automatically trip it as soon as a fish slaps on it, or as soon as you hit bottom with the dodger a couple times, or you get hung up here and there. Whereas this, you can see that rod, and you can learn to watch in your rod tips, and you can see what's going on a lot better. And this has got a longer cable to it than the OR1 release has too. And I really like, especially for fishing lake trout stuff. I mean, you can see, you watch the rod tips, and you'll just see the rod tip just do something like that, and then the rod doesn't move. And we'll wait, and usually when you see it, you wait. Just let it work on it, because as long as it's pulling on that release, it's just doing nothing but burying that hook farther in. And the hard thing is, you see the rod tip, don't run out there and trip it right away. We give it a good 30, 45 seconds or so of working on it, if not longer than that. Give it a good chance to try and pull it out. Then if it don't, you trip it and bring it up. But
and if he does pull it out after pounding on that thing 3 or 4 times, you don't have to be in a hurry. That hook's buried. It's not going anywhere. We had, last year, which tournament was it? Candy Camp. We started out, we had some good fish going, and then it died. Well, we get just about where we're starting to watch, you know, see how many minutes it can take us to get in, and boom, we hit a big lake trout, 13-pound lake trout. Of course, while we're fighting that one, we look over and we see, Nick said, we got one on that one too, and he's not going anywhere. This fish, we landed this, and we're in 125 feet of water on the bottom. So we got this other one in, we look over, and by then he pulled it off, but he was sitting there pounding on it. Didn't matter, he wasn't going anywhere.
We had to use the pliers on both of them.
You will catch more fish, and this is a, you know, manufacturer story, but you can back it up. When you use a release that's got the movement in it, if you've seen videos of salmon, they slap 5, 6, 7 times before they latch onto it. Now, if you've got a rigid release, he slaps and it comes off, that thing's gone over his head. This one, he can bounce, especially along with the OR8, he can bounce the heck out of that until he gets ticked off and finally latches onto it, and you got it. So we've proven over and over again that, and when you get a fish on that one, they're usually there. When you think of how much line you've got out, take a line counter reel someday and go 3 miles an hour and set your rod, set your 30 foot back and lower it down until you get a bend in the rod. You're 70 foot of water, you got 150, 175 feet of line out. So you got a big belly. When that fish hits, he better be hooked up or he's gone. Because he's going frantic and your rod is just doing this. But you put it on this long cable release. If he does pull it off of there, he's hurting. He's got that that big hook in his mouth, and then Nick uses a number one gamma on our wobble glows and stuff. That's just cruel. Those fish, we had to take pliers to get that hook out of their mouth. We don't lose very many fish. We don't catch as many as some of the guys if they're doing better than us, but they're not hooking. If they ever caught on to what we're doing, they're really going to smoke us. So.
Anything else on any of the stuff so far? Tadpoles or anything like that? Before I get into...
How many salmon fishing we got here? Okay. You're a bunch of walleye guys, I hope. You live on Lake St. Clair River, you better be a walleye. Joe won't let you in the door unless you're a walleye.
I need your walleye guys. I love salmon, but I need your walleye guys.
This is our setup for the salmon board. Basically, it's an OR 12. It's rigged a lot different. We don't have a tattle flag on it. With the heavy stuff, the tattle flag isn't going to get a whole lot of use. And usually you get a fish on it. It's pretty obvious there's a fish on these anyways. What we do that's different is just take a little drill, and instead of hooking the release off the back here, we relocate it to down here and off the bottom. What that'll do with the heavier coppers, because this board designed to ride nose high anyways, and I'd rather have a board run like this and then come off a wave and keep doing that than a flat running board, and when it comes off a wave it can do that on you. So by nose high it's not going to dive. And then so with the heavy copper, since it takes it a little farther down, instead of towing from here and the line going down, now at least you're here, and that does bring that up, that angle up a little bit. And the biggest benefit is when you set it up so if it trips, you're bringing it in straight back that way instead of off to the side. And even on that little bit on the side when you're bringing it into the boat, that still does have some little bit of planing in it. It's a little unpredictable sometimes. Whereas if it's coming straight off the back, that just comes straight in, and it just pretty much just comes straight in the boat. This is our snapper release. And the way this is set up, this is the best release if you're going to use the fire lines and the Power Pro stuff. It's got a pad here, and then on the bottom part here, it's grooved in there. So you just clamp that line in there, and if there's a pin right here, and when you snap that forward, that pin fits into a hole in the back. So that'll keep, it works the same way as this release does with the pin in the middle of the pad. So it keeps the line from coming out that way. So if you put it forward, it's not going to trip. It's always going to stay set. So you catch fish, you reel it in, you grab this, you flop that open, pinch it off the line, and then it's in the boat. I like to set it up a lot, especially with the heavy stuff and if I'm running the coppers or fishing for salmon. I like to fold it back. Fold it back, now the line can come out. So the way I'll set it up is I'll set it back, and then you can adjust the tension with this little set screw on the bottom here, this little screw. But I set it in the back position, so now when you get a fish on, you can give it a little pop, and it flips back that way, but yet this release still holds it on the line. Now, if you try that on the Power Pro or Super Line stuff, this is going to slide all the way to your knot. And that's why I really like that section of monofilament. This will hold on to monofilament. It'll hold it in place. So then you just bring it in, then you just take that off the line. If the fish takes off, you don't have to worry about the board diving with the fish or anything like that. Calm water, you can have it fixed solid to the bracket, but I've got it running loose here, especially if you run into the waves a lot. If you're just going with the waves, it's not a big deal, but if you're going to do any kind of trolling into the waves, you run, and this will work, this is the same for walleye or anything too in rough water. You put it loose on the bracket with this split ring. What that'll do is that kind of acts as a knuckle. So as you're going in through the waves and it's jumping along the next wave, it takes up a lot of that motion, so it follows the contour of the waves better, and it's not jumping around and flying all around in the rough water stuff. So that'll help that out quite a bit. And then, I've run 300 coppers with that without problems. I've run 300 copper and tested around and put the tadpole out on it, send it out to the side, and it goes. I mean, it's obviously back a little farther than if I had a clean spoon on it, but it gets the job done, and it definitely definitely pulls that out to the side pretty good. What I didn't bring is one of our little mini boards. We got a little.
I've got one over there.
Have you got one over there?
Yeah, we'll get
one. Okay.
I watched that video on the mini boards, and that's when I brought them in here.
Okay.
But I have to go back and keep watching that video to explain to people how to use them, because I don't fish that way, and mm-hmm. I forget exactly. It was very neat watching that video.
There we go. So this is a mini board. There's a bracket on the back here, and it is a reversible board. So when you put the bracket together, you can snap it in, pop it out, flip it around the other way, and it goes off the other side. But calm water, this is a little steelhead killing machine. We'll put it out there on a nice flat day. You get rough water, it tends to get to the little farther than this little board is made to handle. It's mainly made as a panfish and smaller fish board, but they're so light on the line that I've gotten to where I'll use them any chance I get. So especially if you're out there on a day, a nice sunny flat day, and you can see fish feeding on the surface, or any time I'm out there, if I see a fish splash on the surface, I'm putting one of these out with either just a clean spoon 50 feet behind it, or maybe a little half ounce guppy weight, something just enough to keep the spoon in the water, and the steelhead come up and they love that. They will grab that on the water, and there's not much going through the water up at that, so there's not a whole lot of disturbance of them. And we've seen, you know you're doing it in about the right, because you look back and there'll be a seagull usually following your spoon as it's just under the surface of the water. So
seagull, that's a steelhead killing,
but it's you know, they're nice. You can put a couple in the boat. They don't take up any room.
They're very economical too.
Yeah, 16 bucks. You know, and like I said, they last for both sides, and it's hard to hurt them. I mean, I don't know what you could do to wear it out other than maybe the pads on there, at least this little thing, and so there's so less resistance. And this is another one though, where the key is when you pinch, it's got the light tension OR 10 release on the bracket. That's another one where it's key to do a twist and pinch it on, because there's so little resistance. If you we'll snap it, pop it from the boat, and then reel it in that way. And then a lot of things, you could just kind of snap swivel, so you can let it slide back into your bait, or just to put a 16, a red release on the back, so it just trips and stays in position, and then take it on. So it's so light, trying to pop, and all you can do is drag it across the water. So you put that little twist in there, and when the key is tripping them, is you reel it in, and instead of, you're used to tripping stuff this way, you trip it back towards the motor. So you're kind of going back against the bracket on it a little bit, and it just trips and it slides back. It'll pull decent stuff, as long as you're moving. I mean, we fished the number two tadpoles behind it. We fished number two tadpoles with the big 800 series reef runner behind it. You know, the main limiting factor is the rough water. Calm water, you know, it'll pull great in the calm water.
So you could pull a 2 ounce bottom bomb too.
Yep.
Here. With crawler harness.
Yep. He fishes in the bay. He doesn't have a big board in the boat anymore. So all he's got is a little mini board in his boat.
Right. The biggest quirk the little board has is that with the 12, you can throw it over the side, it's going to right itself, and it's gone. This one, the way I fish it, I set my leads, pinch it on, I use a 16 on the back and the 10 on the front. And then I bring it to the rod tip, set it in the water, and slowly get it started going the right direction. Mm-hmm. Once you get it out 10, 15 feet, you can let go. But if you just let go and it's behind the boat, you're going to not be happy with me. And it's going to go like this and then that, and it's going to trip, and you've got to bring it back in. And you've got all kinds of new names for the offshore guys. But if you'll just give it a start and let it get going its own way, that's fine. You can shut the boat off. You know, you can stop if you got a big fish, and it'll lay there and flop over, and it'll pick up and go again. But that's really about the only little quirk it has. And kind of washing it into the walleye talk is the tattle flags are sensitive. This thing will show you things that, and I mean, Nick and I know how to run tattle flags. This will show you stuff where the tattle flag won't even move. And the board will vibrate like that. Oh, we got a perch bite. When you bring it in, there's a perch or the base tip drop. It's got real potential. I've run I don't run a 2 ounce bouncer very often, but again, it's another item, when you get one, abuse it. You know, put a 3 ounce weight on it, stick it over the side, and it'll disappear, and then a couple seconds later, it'll come pop up and march right back in line. But everybody gets it. Our pro staff, half of them have these in their boat. Never put them, well, yeah, but it won't do, it won't, how do you know it won't? So, abuse them. But I run a half to a 1 ounce guppy inline or snap weight behind it. The other thing, you don't, how with the 12, you can put the rod just about vertical. This one, you need to lower it a little more. When it's out there on the bracket, here, if you rock on a wave, you can tip that bracket up, you'll unload the board, and then it'll flop back north. So if you lower it down some more, not parallel to the water, but lower than you would run the big one, you'll get a lot better performance out of it. And again, you trip it towards the motor. Yes?
We can use that small one on, we don't have a boat, so offshore you can do that?
Mm-hmm. That river be perfect. We have guys they'll fish steelhead for it, and they'll be in the river, and they just find the hole they want and put the bait behind it, and they'll just feed it out, and you can walk it right up along to the hole you want and let it settle in however you want to settle it in.
That's the small one.
Yeah, yep. That's the little one. And that's what's nice with these. Whether you don't need a big regular planer board rod. If you put it on a little Zebco 202 combo, it doesn't need...
I'm going fishing little, 101.
Like a kid's, think a kid's rod. Oh, you can run a planer board with that. Oh, it doesn't pull much on it.
We do a lot of fishing with 6 pound spinning reel and 6 pound test line. You know, cast it out, give her a couple of pulls, put the board on, put it in the rod.
What about 40 pound test?
Well, it'll hold 40 pounds.
It'll hold anything.
Yeah, anything there up. Yeah. Yep. We're trying to get where, you know, you're going to an inland lake someplace, and the last thing you want to do is have to go out and buy one of these kind of concoctions for inland lake fishing. You got the kids with you. You don't need any extra equipment with this. You really don't with that one either. But this one we designed for panfish inland lake, and it's doing things that we never expected it to do. Like Nick said, it's become my go-to board.
So you've heard from people that have used it off like a...
Oh, yeah. Yep. Got catfish guys down in the Missouri River.
Oh. Yep. We've got, well, Marianne's got that shore trolling, she calls it. Marianne Husky, she's putting I think she's going to have a video on it or an article on it here coming up. On doing that like off the banks and off the beaches when you're catching the fish off the beach. Yeah. Just putting it out and just walking along the beach with it. Pulling it that way. And what's nice because it's reversible. So you get a nice open space, you can put it out the way you want it, walk down the beach with it, reel it in, flip the bracket around the other way, and turn around and walk back the other way with it.
I mean, exercise.
It's it's different, but there's ways of doing it, and there's people catching fish with it. And
walking a fish.
Yeah. So I mean, you'll get some interesting conversations from people around you, I'm sure, but you know, it works. And the river thing is, it's used, I think, a lot more than we think. You start talking to a few more people about it, and a lot of guys have done the steelhead thing with it, and there's a current, it'll go out, and you can just feed it out, and you can, if you want to cast, or you do whatever you do, and you can put a rod on the shoulder, and the shore on a holder, put that out, and then go cast, and well, that's, and it's just like watching a bobber. It'll just, if that fish will get it, it just takes off. Really?
Well, in winter steelhead, you put a small crankbait, you know, if you're in a drift boat, you're going down through there fast, then the crankbait gets one pass through the hole. If you're standing on the bank or waiting, you can put your crankbait behind this. You can work it through the hole, work it back up, slide it out some more. So you can cover that hole, kind of like hand lining. You just kind of vacuum the area through, and if you don't have a fish, there's none there, you move to the next hole. But it's, again, just experiment with it and make it do things.
How much chop is too much?
1 foot
or too much?
I mean, going with them, you can do a decent amount. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, I'd say you get up into the 3 foot range. It all depends on what you're trying to do with them. You know, if you're trying to run a ways out, you know, then, you know, 2 foot might be too much. But if you just want to get it so it's just away from the boat, that going with them isn't bad. What happens when you're going against them, what happens is eventually, since they're so light, they can get tossed around in the waves a little bit, and sometimes they'll get rolled over and flipped over, and then it's a little tough to work with, because there isn't ballast with them. It's just the plastic, and they're just, you know, they float on their own, but there's nowhere near the flotation that those have on it. So they're pretty much ocean dependent on it. So if you're going to get some rough waves and stuff, they're a little harder to use. But I'm, you know, inland lake stuff, and we didn't build them to run, you know, four foot waves and stuff with them anyway.
But the second time it jumps out of the water and trips,
you bring it in,
you put the other one back.
The nice thing is, if it takes off on you, it's not like this thing where you got to free spool it and you're going to break a rod or you got to worry about this. You just hang on to it. It'll go through, and eventually it'll find itself, and it pops itself up, and then it goes. It's a little tough because there's not, once it starts going, it's these things with that foam and stuff in it, it'll pop right back up to the surface. Where these, usually we found, we've tried spooling it out, but usually it's just as easy to keep the tension on it, and it'll right itself up and pull itself up. So it doesn't pull nearly as hard as that big board. And I've used a couple of them after cranking in these, the big ones for time after time, and then putting that on there, it's like just having a regular bobber on the line. There's really nothing to it at all.
Got any other questions?
You might want to touch on how the board's being packaged now, and maybe
Previously, I know, and I've got some for you to switch series out. You look on the boards, they used to come with orange release, which is just a heavy tension release. It's the same tension as the red ones that come in the snap weight releases and the tattle flight kits, but it doesn't have the pin in it, so it can trip. And it used to come with two of those orange ones on it, a front and the back. Well, now, there's a lot of times you buy the board, and then you get a pair of boards, so then you go, get that, and then you get another pair of releases, swap out the back releases with the red ones, so this way, if the board does trip, you're not losing it. With that little pin in the back there, it keeps it from coming off the line. It won't come off the line with that pin in it. So now, it comes right in the package now with that red release on the back of it. So now it's by putting that on there. We're still working on some, we had some packaging issues with that as well as with the Magnum tadpoles. These are going to be available fairly sure. They should be in stock by the time we start this spring, the salmon fishing. By the time the fishing's going, we'll have these ready to go. The ones and twos are available now. But we also have what we call an economy tattle flight kit for walleye fishermen. Instead of having to buy the board and then the whole kit with the two releases and the extra flag and all that stuff in it, for about half the price, we've got an economy tattle flight kit that has everything but the releases and the flag. So now when you buy a board that's got the orange release on the front and the red one on the back, there's no real reason to have any more releases unless you want to switch to the snapper release on it anyway. So for, I don't know, it's, they're going to be anywhere from probably 10 to 12 to 15 bucks or something on it. So, and that's going to be the normal, the same thing as the other one, but just without the releases and the flag in it.
So you'll be able to
save a decent amount of money now to buying a board and a tattle flag kit.
Something we don't get around here a lot, and I've got a bigger boat and I don't walleye fish well with it here because of the current. We don't get a lot of guys using inline boards up and down the beach fishing for walleye. They're fishing the same way they did for the last 20 years. They're not
switching. 50 years.
Exactly. It's something that I want to work on, and I know Mick's that should be his job also, being a promoter offshore, is to get something like that going. Mm-hmm. I've dabbled with it. I've caught fish, but I know the guys out vertical jigging are out fishing me. But
well, you're in a river, and one of the things about river fish is they're almost always bottom oriented. Mm-hmm. So this inline is more of a suspended bite,
right.
And we may never be popular in the river.
Right.
Other than for the spring salmon and steelhead that run right. Up suspended. But, you know, 90% of your fish in a river are going to be right. Within a foot of the bottom. And that's the way it is. You know, we're not going to replace anybody's systems. We're giving you another round in the chamber. You wouldn't go fishing with just chartreuse jigs.
Right.
So that's all we're looking at. And this certainly is not. Now, I know guys that have set off their dock, though.
Oh, yeah.
With a board out there and the other downrod here and back up their house having coffee, watching the board come behind the dock, running down.
Right.
You know, and not getting too many tickets doing that. But, but yeah, it has its place.
Yep.
We're certainly not trying to push it. It's like we're getting after the crappie guys. We won the Crappie Masters Championship in Granada, Mississippi this year. 192 boats. I sent two teams down just to give us a little showing. We put a display up and all this stuff. And I said, you guys just, you know, do kind of good, okay? Just don't embarrass us. Well, we ended up first and second. All on boards. There were 192 teams. Only seven teams caught seven fish each day. Our two teams culled fish every day.
They were catching 20 fish a day. Both teams.
On crankbaits and the full-size board, the tattle flag. So it's had a bunch of them boys down south. They don't like having money taken out of their pocket. This was about 60 grand they lost. This is the 20th year, I think, of this Crappie Masters Championship. Five guys have won every tournament. One of five teams have won every tournament. And for some guys from up north, well, they were from Iowa, so it wasn't completely up north. But to go down to Mississippi and do that to them, it's like, whoa, we got a lot of ears perked up on this. So we're hoping to get the that going there. But again, it's, you know, well, nobody does that. Well, nobody, when we first went to Lake Erie, them weight forward guys says, well, we're going to smoke you. You guys come down with your dial. When they come in with their limit of fish like this, and we're using two baskets to bring six fish to the box, to the scales, we've completely changed Lake Erie.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in the process of doing that here. And, I mean, I remember my first planer board on a mast had the Riviera release screwed to the top of the wooden board, single board. You threw that out, and when you caught a fish, you brought that whole works in. I mean, who the heck come up with this shower curtain hook stuff on a slide them out there? Mm-hmm. I mean, we just changed the way you planer board fish. And then, of course, we developed those boards. Riviera's got that triple board, and it'll pull musky baits, yep. All of them you want to put on it, and it's a brutal. But that's what we've done. By not being stuck in the way, well, we always do it this way. My dad did it this way. His dad did it this way. The tournament guys don't have any rules like that. Mm-hmm. And then their battle, your battle, is to get these guys that have always done it this way to experiment with something new. And again, with our products, this thing's been a work in progress since 1993. It's never been finished, and we don't know what's coming next to it. One of the other things we have done, though, is Offshore no longer makes any lead products. This is a zinc, lead-free. These are zinc. Our tadpoles. Nothing. We don't make lead anymore. So, for what that is, I don't think we're ever going to outlaw lead, but we think it was a good move. And what we really discovered, what pushed us into it, this was supposed to have been 3.8 ounces. And we found some of them that weighed 3 ounces, some weighed 4.2 ounces. All exact same size. Same piece of lead. But we don't have control because you're not buying virgin lead, we're buying scrap lead. So if you got a big pour of wheel weights or you got a good hunk of lead pipe, you had different weights. These with 10%, a 1 ounce weight we found from 0.9 to 1.1. Now if you're fishing a precision bite and you've got one weight that's half ounce or a 1 ounce, 30 back, and it's catching fish, you put another one out, you can't buy a fish on it. You could be 0.2 ounce, which is a lot of weight in 1 ounce when you're going across the lake at 1.2 miles an hour pulling a spinner. When we went to the die cast, these things are within 3 decimal points. I mean, they're virtually the same. So now, if you're catching fish half 30 back on this one with a silver blade, that one should catch fish half 30 back. Lead, it didn't do it. You know, besides the ecology part, we're, you know, doing what we can do to keep the lead, and I really don't think that means much. I mean, not many people eat sinkers. Not many people have a problem. All of us here that are over 40 chewed on the crib when we were little, and that was lead paint. And, you know, other than my hair falling out, I had no side effects. But we thought it was a good, once we discovered the difference between lead, we said, well, we're a precision company. We like to be able to duplicate your program. That's how you catch walleye. It's got to go back the same way the next time you'll catch fish. We decided to make this very expensive change into this injection molding stuff and our weights, and here's where we are now with it. And we know it's catching more fish than what we did before. The consistency of being able to duplicate the program has been there. Walleye is really critical. You know, our salmon, we got clear water, you've got a more latitude to work with. With walleye, they get into a zone and they're not, you know, you get one 30 back, you hear the guy, well, I'm 11 back or 37 back. He's not 40 back. You know, it'd be nice and easy to put a 40 back, but he's 37. And Tommy Scarless sets all his. I couldn't figure out, well, he said, I'm 65 and I'm 56 and I'm 74. And where do you get all these numbers from? He said, they all add up to 11. He sets his spread so that the numbers, because I can remember that, it's got to add up to 11. So that's how Tommy Scarlett sets his spread out. It was 74 foot, 65 foot. You know what? The man's a world champion angler, so what can you say? We got a favorite number, Nick and I, for years, was aces, 111. And we've gone all over the country, set a dipsy, a downrigger, a snap weight, a tadpole at 111. And we've caught fish everywhere at 111. Now, part of the reason is 111 on any of those systems puts you in that 40 to 50 foot down, which is probably 3/4 of the fish we catch are in that 40 to 60 range. So that's one of the reasons. But it's always that we can always get on the boat, we look at each other's. One of us will have something at 111 forever. We've done that for 20 years fishing together. But that's where we're at with that ecology, with the consistency of the weight of this molded zinc or lead. And there's places where it doesn't matter, but we feel with what we're doing and the way we promote our product line, it's critical to be able to duplicate the program. Now, we got any walleye questions out here? Not river walleye.
How about Harbor Beach? I get a lot of phone calls. What's going on Harbor Beach in July?
July?
And I know the Saginaw Bay fish come down.
Harbor Beach is interesting because we got two things going on there. There's a couple places that you can always go to catch a few fish. And there's not many people going, you know, fishing out there. So you've got the same people all the time fishing. So typically, when you catch fish in a spot, you go to your same spot and do the same thing you've been doing. So you've got the humps, the main spots, there's the humps. There's everybody says straight out, which is in front of the radio towers, which is maybe, 3/4 or a mile north, maybe at that. And then out in, talking more of depth. So it's not quite a spot north and south as much as the depth contour on where you're working. So and they move. They seem to have been moving fairly quick, and in the spring, you know, May will be right up on the shore, and but they'll go, by the time we get into that, the late May tournaments, you might touch that shallow stuff, but most of your big stuff, you're going right on out to 90, 120 foot of water right now. And they just, you kind of work that depth, you kind of figure out where they're at, you get a read. I usually start out, I like to touch that 50 to 60 foot early in the morning. If there's salmon hanging out, usually you'll get them in there in that early daylight kind of bite. Make a couple passes. As soon as the sun starts getting up, I just point it out. You know, I just point east and go. You know, you get a couple spots and you get a fish, you can turn around and come right back on it. And you come through, there's nothing, you turn right back out and just keep on going. It is There's so much water to cover. Back in the days when you'd have 100 boats out fishing, you can kind of tell where the schools were. You can kind of follow where the fish were moving around, and you'd go around the outside of the pack, and you could pick them off there instead of ganging them with everybody inside. But now you've got two boats 5 miles north. You got one boat inshore. You got a guy playing around by the wall, and there's maybe one other boat outside of you way out in 220 foot of water. And it's just so much water to cover with so few boats it's really tough to experiment. And that's why I like going fast. I get those days when there's not a real, when you can tell, the guys that are there, they're pretty active on the radio, and most of the guys are real good at helping out and telling you what's going on, or at least giving you an idea where the fish are at. So you get the depth they're working. And otherwise, I just hammer down 3.5, 3.8, and just cover water. And I have 3 pound lake trout hit 4 miles an hour. There's no rules there. The fish are scattered. There's a lot of fish, but they're scattered all over the place. And especially when you get into that midsummer, the biggest issue we have without the structure is the water temperatures is the same. You're 120 foot of water and it's 70 degrees on the bottom. So there's no, at least if you get a thermocline set up, you can kind of gauge, it'll orient the fish a little bit. With that kind of water, I mean, that's why we're catching walleye 90 feet down. You know, there's just, and how do you target a walleye that's in 90 foot of water, you know, 120 foot of water 90 feet down? Is no way to do it.
Now, if you like to get up early in the morning, or if you like to get up in the middle of the night, this will tell you how much fish move. Nick and I, we're like cracking nine. We like to go fishing 7:30, 8 o'clock maybe. And well, the last tournament we fished, they were all out there, and we're filling the boat. We're getting ready to go. We just let them go out. But we're catching steelhead in 200 feet of water. That their stomach is so full of June bugs that when you touched it, the stomach broke open. Now, they didn't get those June bugs in 200 feet of water. And these guys that are going out at 4:30 in the morning, they're having a heyday for an hour and a half, 2 hours. Right up in 40, 60, 70 foot of water, north of the harbor. We've never participated because we're not getting up that early. But those same fish, when we get there at 7 o'clock, you can't buy a fish there. You got to go out 80, 90 feet. So these fish are swimming several miles, coming in, and who knows when they come in at night. But that's, I mean, there's guys that have had 12, 15 fish between 4:30 or 5 o'clock and when the sun cracks the horizon. Kind of like what Lake Michigan. Again, when you can see a cannonball 30, 40 feet down, these fish are going to be touching, which is why our copper and our, you know, our 150, 200, 300 foot leads are catching fish, I think. And you'll turn around, you'll catch a lake trout 3 foot behind the ball. You know? Right. So, I don't know. It makes good stories, but copper works. But the fish are there early in the morning, and then they're gone out in deep water. We know salmon from people that did telemetry. They'll swim 20 miles a day, twice a day, to eat, and go back out where they're comfortable, come back in again. When I ran charters, the guys that, I left at 7 then too, but the Sammy and them boys out of Grindstone, they'd be out there at 5:30 in the morning and tell, oh yeah, we got them going good here, going there, going here, and I'd hear the next guy, he'd be a couple miles further out, I'd blow right out to deep water and set right on top of them salmon over there. Well, we haven't had a bite in 2 hours, and here it is, nice daylight, I had a good night's rest, and we're just wailing on the fish out there. By the time they caught up to us, they were gone from where we were, and I mean, I don't know how far they go. But I know that biologists have said 20 miles is nothing for a king to travel, to feed, and then go back to their comfort zone. And in July, the north of town there's some. They seem to catch more walleye in that area in the 30 to 50, 60 foot range. Mm-hmm. And if you want to go out there and run a 2-3 ounce bottom bouncer with a tube jig, and you want to get some monster smallmouth, find them humps out there. There are smallmouth out there sitting on the bottom that no one's ever put a lure by. And when they, yeah, when they come up there and you see a 5-pound smallie hauling a 3-ounce bottom bouncer out of the water, it's like, wow. So I'd love to get out there with somebody that knows how to fish bass, which I don't. I went and fished with Al Linear this year and had fun. But get out there in that deep water with real good boat control and tube jig like they do in Lake Erie. I think there's a smallmouth fishery that would put us on the map just doing that.
The state record's going to come from up in here soon.
I wouldn't be surprised.
I've waited in a lot of 7, 7.5.
Yeah, that's a lot. I mean, there's no secret crazy trick out there. There's a lot of spoons still. The salmon are still getting most of the salmon and the magnums. The salmon out there, if there's one alewife left out there, the salmon is going to eat it.
This year?
They're hunting. They'll eat whatever they got to eat. But it's not. That's the one thing that I'm starting to see with the salmon is, you know, the old match the hatch thing, all their smells. If you want to catch salmon, you still put salmon spoons down because they want that alewife. It doesn't matter if there's all these smelt, if there's a lot of smelt the size of this room, if there's a half a dozen alewife swimming through them, those salmon are going to fight right by those smelt and eat those 6 alewife that are in the thing. And that's talking with a biologist, what they found in their stomachs, the very little alewife that they found in Lake Huron yet, they found them in the salmon's belly. They found them in the salmon. Now, enough to count in one hand, but enough to, you know, that's what they're still looking for. So it's not, well, they're going to see it all. They don't, that doesn't look like a smelt, so I'm not going to eat that. They said, that's an alewife. I'm going to go chase that thing down and eat it.
Well, so, we're going to go down south crappie fishing, and most of those lakes have got alewife in them. We're going to salt down alewife. Instead of doing herring, we're going to, well, that's tournament.
It's too late.
But I mean, if they want alewife, yeah, that's it. They said there's what, 15 alewife per square mile or something was their netting samples, and 90% of the food in the king salmon's stomach was an alewife. And them fish are getting skinny just looking for one of them 15 alewife in a square mile. But that's what they want.
Steelhead, probably the best, something I still, my main go-to rod for steelhead there is a 3-color lead. We've been working more and more on the tadpoles, and now that we got the releases, so we can run the long release on the tadpoles, we'll get some time to work that out more. That 3-color lead core has just been a staple for steelhead. Put a spoon behind that, and steelhead, as long as it's got orange on it, it's good to go. I mean, I don't care what color you put in there, as long as it's got some orange on it. Whether it's solid orange or a belly or whatever, they love that, and you put that on. And usually after May, or most of the time we're out fishing, that's one of the first rods in the water. It's going to be that 3-color lead core for the steelhead, and it's highly productive on that. 300 copper stuff always catches lake trout and salmon and stuff like that. You really want to work on some lake trout, you go down to the bottom with a Dodger. This has been the hottest one. Joel said they're not making them anymore, it's so you got them, hang on to them. And then this spinning glow here has been, this Dodger and this spinning glow has probably caught 90% of my lake trout in the last 5 years, just mostly because it's the main one I use. But I haven't really found a whole lot of reason to get real fancy with them. It goes down there, it catches fish all the time. Sometimes they want it just along the bottom. You tighten it up a little bit behind the ball, maybe 4 foot behind the ball, and just work that bottom with the rigger that goes down. You just, every once in a while you want to be able to go down, and every once in a while you want to see your rods come up from a tapping on the bottom. You know, and if you're working the bottom like that, and if you're sitting down, you're not on the bottom. You need to be, you live on that rigger, and you tap it, and it's up and down, and up and down, and up and down. The last few years, it's been nice that we've been able to get away with tapping bottom, and then bringing it up 5 feet, and letting it work across the top of the bottom, and when you do that, you can run a little longer lead on it, because that'll let this flow a little bit more behind the downrigger, and with that little longer lead, it's got a bigger path, and what you get is every once in a while, it'll flutter, and then it'll kick down, and it kicks up a big chunk of silt or whatever sand off the bottom, and then as this comes through, that spinning glow is behind it. This kicks through and gets their attention, and then that spinning glow flies through their face, and just out of instinct, they grab it. So, and that's pretty much, not guaranteed fish, but that's, if you're really looking for, you get a slow day where you're really wanting to work on some stuff, you work the bottom out with that. Usually that, the 80 to the 90 foot range, if you can find a little hump, find a little bit of a structure like that, you can work in and out on. Sometimes they like to work along it, but usually I like to go up back and forth over the structure and work it up and come down on it. As far as the spinning blow, usually I'll do it, it's a wrap, or a wrap and a half around the dodger, as far as the lead lengths. So you just take it and you, there's one and a half, so this one's almost two, but you know, that's your standard. Sometimes you run them a little longer, but you want a 20 inch lead off the back of it. Beads, I really don't care. I put beads on to make it look the way I like it. I don't think the beads itself makes a whole lot of difference. Going through all that stuff, if there's two red ones and a yellow one, or a green and a light green, I just put on what I put on that looks cool. Other than that, that's
about it. Any more questions?
They'll stick around for a little bit.
And yeah, we'll be hanging around for a while.
Make sure you guys grab their we got magazines. Papers. Those are the 14.
Newspapers have all different ways of running pretty much most of the stuff that we've talked about, and some more things on there. Everything from smallmouth to maintaining releases and replacing pads and all those kind of stuff. So
another thing too, with the tadpole and the guppy weight system, we're now, you know, tournament guys, we carry everything, even a hockey stick if you think you might need it. With the guppy weight at the small box and the tadpoles, we created space. We used to carry everything, 1 ounce, half ounce, all up to 8 ounce left, you know, inline sinkers and everything. It's all consolidated now. We've now created space.
More lures.
Yeah. All around for the Deshano. Thanks, guys.